guess I, thanks for the invite to come and speak to you today. I guess my focus has been on economic drivers for restoration. And in WA, I'm not too sure in South Australia, but we've got 13 million hectares of cleared agricultural land. Some of that land should never have been cleared. And really the focus of my work isn't the urban and peri-urban work that's mostly being discussed today. So I hope it's sort of relevant to you. I'm not too sure where the pointer.
There's one there.
Anyway, you see these in these photos here, some of the work that I've kind of been associated with. On your left-hand side is one of the brushwood group of species, and here we're...
Don't show it in their eyes.
I'll use descriptions instead. So we've got Nullipatra viridis, saltland brushwood sort of species, and we're doing some biomass assessment on that. In the middle photo here is one of the tuberous species that I've been working on to develop a new vegetable crop industry in WA. Interestingly, when I applied for funding to do that work, the federal government said, we've never heard of this species, so it can't be real, so we won't give you the funding. And then one of them came to WA and we went out in the field and dug them up, and then they were on the same page. Anyway, so as you can see, there's not a lot of native grass there. There might be a bit in this, underneath the brushwood there. And a lot of my time has been spent trying to establish a West Australian sandwood industry back in the cleared agricultural land. And of course, this species also occurred in South Australia as well. And then in about 2002, I thought, if I were doing it for everyone else, I might as well buy a farm ourselves. So we bought some land between Albany and Perth in southwest WA. It gets about 450 mils of annual rainfall. And according to my board acre farmers around us, which is mostly sort of sheep and wheat sort of country, we bought the shittiest land in the district. That's precisely what I wanted to do, because it was cheap for the rainfall. And as you can see here, we've got a massive salt problem there, a little chain of swamps there. But I was lucky to secure, you can't really sort of see it, but you can, there's a the farm boundary sort of marked to the right hand side of that, those salty areas there, and I've been growing a whole range of plants for commercial purposes. It does sound a bit businessy, but I used a commercial model for this land purchase, and the National Australia Bank backed it at the time. I don't think they back it now, way too risky. But we're able, with seed sales, we paid for the land and all the operating costs in the first 4 years. So the model does work if you do a good business plan. And that's what I suggest anyone who wants to get into any native plant industry, write themselves a business plan. If you're still writing the business plan in 5 years' time, well then forget it, because you're obviously not that committed. But do spend the time to do a good business plan. So over the last sort of 15 years, I don't just do research, I try and do quick practical things as well. And I've helped set up about 105 plantations, about 3,500 hectares that I've been involved in. And really, when I started, this is sort of interesting maybe for your native grass work, the commercial price for establishing an Australian sandal plantation about $3,000 a hectare. We're now rolling out on scale at about 2,500 hectares a year at about $150 to $120 a hectare. So if you really want to get adoption of some of these native plant industries, you've got to try and make things more cost effective. And one way is to reduce your establishment costs. I've been involved in a lot of other sort of restoration sort of projects, but a lot of them aren't native grass based. And I'm always on the tractor each year myself, since sort of mid-90s as well. But really what I thought might be kind of useful for today is thinking about maybe putting together some agronomy sort of packages for some of your native grasses. And for me, I've sort of developed ones for Australian sandalwood, growing tropical sandalwoods in arid zones. I'm using the native flora. We've done some fodder and combined sandalwood fodder systems, and now that's been rolled out sort of commercially. Some other ones for Mellow Cattributus and those root tube roots that I was talking about beforehand, and some new sort of ways to do some of these biodiversity plantings at scale. Again, sorry that there's no grasses here, but this is what gets a lot of broadacre farmers pretty happy. That's a beautiful clover-based pasture in amongst mostly legumes. In there is also sandalwood, which is a good example of a parasitic plant that recycles nutrients. So under the cases, the parasitic plants, being the sandalwood, grabbing the nutrients, dumping it on the ground, unlike most other Australian native plants, and then getting good grass growth underneath the legumes and the parasitic plants. I've done a lot of work with sort of machinery development. A lot of that's not anything to do with most of my sort of research interest. Mostly it all happens in a big shed at my place, and cutting things up and adjusting them. And really, over the years, we've sort of modified a whole heap of agricultural equipment. My strategy was never to try and reinvent the wheel, but use horticulture and agriculture. They've got massive big R&D budgets and use things from agriculture and horticulture. That's a bit of a list of all the different machines that I've been involved in. As I say, all my work's been on commercial plants to drive the revegetation. You know, you only have to use some of the figures that have been used today and try and scale up to, say, a million hectares of native grass in amongst our cropping country, and you end up with a bloody big bill. So it's unlikely to get adopted at scale if they're the cost. A lot of my work's focused on developing cheap and reliable systems for establishing native plants on cleared agricultural land. And quite a few contractors in WA use part of all of those systems now. We've sort of talked about direct seeding, so I'll just skip over that slide. People realise it's a cheap and way to do things. But the areas that I've sort of worked on is sort of the equipment design, moisture management. If you think of a seed, it's great to have viable seeds, but seeds need a few things to get established, and we're living in a Mediterranean type environment as well in South Australia, and so managing moisture is critically important. So it's the way the seeds are sown, and seed pre-treatments that other people have talked about, pest control and seedling nutrition are all really important. So essentially, you know, in the mid sort of land care sort of days, we're pretty much just scattering out seeds and hoping for the best. We then started to use bits and pieces from agriculture. This bottom slide's got something, it's a Green Australia little seeding machine. And then we retrofitted it with an Ausplough agricultural seeding arm on it. And from there we went to developing sort of prototype machinery, but purpose-built machinery. And then, to cut a long story short, and the problem is with the machine, people love to kick tyres, but really it's only part of a whole establishment program. But whenever you have a field day and there's a machine there, everyone's sort of around there kicking tyres or whatever. It's a funny thing to do, I guess, isn't it? But really then, we've come up with this sort of three lines sort of scalping. You can see some big scalpers down on the bottom part of the machine there. You can see two on the right-hand side, and essentially the whole thing's run by hydraulics, but it's still portable, so you can still move it down the highway from site to site. It's built out of 5mm RHS, so it doesn't really bend too well, but it goes through tree stumps and bounces over rocks and things. So that's sort of the machinery side of things, and then in terms of adoption, we've got a few corporate groups working at about 2,000 hectares sort of line, right through to some small NRM groups that have used it for about 600 hectares or so. So be being adopted. One of the big issues when you start putting lots of hydraulics and knobs and things on this sort of machinery is that often if it's used by multiple farmers, the machine gets damaged and it takes a long time for people to come up to speed on how to adjust community-owned machinery. As you can see there. But essentially, it's not rocket science. It's essentially just a cog-driven seeder, really. And that's the real take-home message. There's cog-driven seeders, and really they're part of a whole establishment package. So then if we leave the machinery side of things alone for a while, we just go into simple things like seed preparation. The amount of times I've had inquiries from people about trying to sow various native plants, including grasses, and they're having difficulty. And often they're quite simple things that need to be done. I mean, the Mariana here, for example, people threshing at high relative levels of high humidity, it's much more difficult to clean it down to a fairly pure seed, whereas at low relative humidity, it's quite a simple process. And the same here with the triodias. It's quite simple to get it down to pure seed or close to pure seed, so it can go through a cog-driven seeder. But it's just you just need to develop the sort of methodology for each sort of species you're interested in. Also, spent a fair amount of time looking at new sort of weed control strategies, and again, basing it on agriculture that's got all that R&D capacity, and here you can see the control of wire weed, which I gather is probably a weed around here as well. Here we're using imazamox at label rate to take out the wire weed, preserve the acacias and some of the melaleucas and eucalypts that we're sowing. So it sounds like you're already on to all that sort of stuff, so that's good. Continue along those lines, I think it's quite useful, but what I would say on that is it's always good to have response surfaces to herbicides. So if you're going to do herbicide work, it's better to do a gradient spray and work out the response surface to a herbicide, and then you can avoid those sort of problems that most of the other speakers had, where they got the label, the rate wrong, and they had a disaster. If you do a gradient type spray response, it'll tell you how much flexibility you've got when you get the rate wrong. So you know some of the systems that I've got for different groups of broadleaf plants. We know there's a 4x safety margin for a particular group of herbicides. So it really doesn't matter if you've got pretty much a novice person doing the spraying, unless they really, really cock it up, it's going to work. But you know other herbicides, if they've got a different sort of response surface to the herbicide, the plants you want to grow, you know you'll be much more careful with them. And then finally, I thought I'd start talking about a few native grass that will work in a minute. But so this is a good example of some work I did with John Moore on the response to cases of different herbicides. And then I think what you need for some of these native grasses, particularly if you want to get broad acre, and I say broad acre, you know, sort of hundreds, thousands of hectares established, you need to develop some sort of agronomic package, some really good extension material on how people are going to go about doing it, and some good economic analysis. This is just one of the little publications I wrote for one of the root vegetables that I've been working on, to try and help growers get established and make some good decisions. I've done a reasonable amount of work on sort of tree crop interactions. As you can see here, the grass growth under different perennial woody perennials is quite different. You can just see it under the eucalypts and one of the acacia species there, differences. And you can also see differences in the time taken to hay off with the pasture there. But again, that's mostly ryegrass, so we still haven't talked about native grasses yet. I won't go my whole talk about talking about native grass. But anyway, this is some other work I've been doing with legumes, trying to get the legumes to produce better quality grazing actually underneath the legumes. It's always good to quantify all the costs and the benefits, not just biomass production if you're into grazing. and sheep. These guys here, they're the cheapest breeding team you can buy for managing the she-oak woodland here. If you compare that to a pruning team, these guys certainly win the race. I spent a little bit of time on some of the dwarf she-oaks as fodder shrubs in Western Australia. I'm not too sure if we've got many prostrate alocasuranas and casuaranas. And I've done a little bit of work on Sproblis virginicus, the selections from WA. And some of the work that I've been involved in has been getting some responses to urea application with Sproblis virginicus. And that's yielded some pretty interesting information. But whether it's going to be adopted by broadacre agriculture, I'm less convinced. I spent a lot of time, because most of my work is in that sort of 450 down to sort of 300 mil rainfall zone, working on moisture management systems. And here you can see some great scalping lines. But you can see one's harvested a bit too much water, and a lot of our plants rot away when we've harvested that much water. And on the left-hand side, we've got a different sort of scalp profile, and we've still harvested some water, but we haven't put the seeds into underwater. Been using the northeastern part of the wheatbelt, which is probably similar to your sort of peninsula cropping country. Putting quite large water harvesting structures in before we do any seeding at all. I'm trying to take out the climate risk, so it's a way of adapting to that risk. And you can see here where the person's hand is, that scalp's worked exceptionally well. You can see the dry soil on the edges there, so it's worked. It's given us essentially some money in the bank. We'll be able to harvest some water, shove it down nice and deep, so that we can use, we only need another 5 or 6 mils to do the seeding on, and we should have a good success. So it's about dealing with risk. Here's a good example of some of the variation in soil moisture, and by doing this sort of pre-scalping work, we've been able to ensure that when we come to do seeding, we've got a nice uniform soil moisture bank. I guess from a West Australian perspective, I would say the native grass industry is probably where you guys were 20 years ago, I reckon. That's just my sort of take on it. There have been a few trial plots of different native grasses using different establishment techniques, and some of those have worked well. The scalping, as been described today, has worked fairly well, and the use of burning also. But really, Lefroy wrote an article, I think it was in the 1990s, early 1990s, saying what an opportunity the native grasses in WA had. And to be perfectly honest, not much has happened since he wrote that article. So, in contrast, there are now about 100,000 hectares of the subtropical perennial grasses now in the Mediterranean sections of the West Australian Wheatbelt through groups like the Evergreen Group. But they're all based on exotic perennial grasses, Kaikoura and all sorts of other things. And really, native grasses have actually been sown in agricultural landscapes, not urban and peri-urban, sort of, probably less than 1,000 hectares. However, there's been a real bonus to some work that's gone on from sort of restoration type works, is that we've got a lot of establishment of native grasses back in restored sort of ecosystems for either, and people are using that for grazing. I guess some of the issues with some of the subtropical perennial grasses in Western Australia, seed costs, and establishment, pretty much the establishment is well under $100 a hectare. And from what what I can sort of gather already for the native seeds, that grass seed, it's really 10 to 20 times that of these perennial grasses. And we want to drive adoption. reduce establishment costs and also document how productive they are from a grazing perspective and how they fit in a grazing enterprise. And this was a trial that was done in 2007, and I don't know how these prices of native grasses compare to South Australian prices, but they're pretty expensive. And as I say, if we want to drive adoption on a broad scale, that's one area we can certainly try to address. But really, some of the key components of our overall establishment strategy that I look for is really good site assessment, getting a good seed mix and seed procurement sort of strategy, the vertebrate and the insect pest strategy, the sowing approach and the niche creation, working out some sort of nutritional strategy. My work on other native grasses, not necessarily native grasses, but the dogma is that they don't really want any extra nutrition, whereas a lot of soils, I don't know if it's just the WA soil, but supplementary nutrition can make it into a really good establishment or very poor establishment for persistence. The timing of sowing operations and having some sort of plasticity and knowing what the key drivers are, when and how to sow. Mixing and blending sort of strategy, moisture management, the economic analysis is really, really critical if you want broad scale adoption. And if you're talking about broad acre agriculture, it's the management and the grazing strategy that goes with the establishment strategy. I'll really flip through this really quickly. What's kind of, I found kind of interesting, these are this picture of sort of a restored ecosystem is on really hard setting clay, and I've built this sort of system where we're using the native grasses, encouraging the native grasses to recolonise these clay soils. I mean, they're seriously hard clay soils. So you just, you know, you get your axe or just sort of bounces off these in the middle of summer, using the native grasses and then spraying out the native grasses in autumn and then sowing the actual woody species back into the dead clumps of native grass. It essentially acts as a bit of a jiffy pot within these sort of clay soils, and it's been really, really successful, and it's hugely cost effective. This is just some work we did with Sprotulus virginicus and comparing to Disticulus many years ago, and now it's just a sward of Sprotulus and Disticulus, Disticulus being the grass, Sprotulus being the native grass there. It's quite an impressive site given the sort of the way it looked when we first did it. It was pretty much a bare salt skull, which you can see in the background there. And I'll finish off with this site, which is really, I work in the sort of Midwest, which is really large scale. You know, it's the total land probably is over 10,000 hectares. And you can see here we've got broadleaf wandery grass and tall lotus being the fodder value that's coming into these altered ecosystems that we've got. So we're not actually sowing wandery grass into these systems, but because they're not being cropped, they're now being used to grow other products. For now, we've got a grazing strategy that now goes with the introduction of the establishment of the native grasses. So now there's a grazing strategy that's now happening on these in these systems, and they're very large scale systems. So that's a nice thing. And there are lots of people sort of playing around at a fairly small scale, getting things like them that are growing in Western Australia as well, but I think we are miles behind you guys. But there are some people doing some pretty interesting things, using things like spray seed to take out a lot of other competitors, so you get a much better, cleaner seed harvest. I'm not sure if anyone's using spray seed to control the annual weeds, and you apply it just when the dimmer is still fairly dormant. But really there's a lack of adoption, and I think it's the perception of a high cost, low returns. Certainly need cost WA there's quite a group of people that are concerned about bringing the same native grass but different provinces over to Western Australia, and really I don't have any understanding of whether that's a real issue or whether it's a non-issue. Chloris has got a really bad reputation in parts of WA, even though it's native to some parts, and there are issues with wool and skin issues. How do we encourage adoption in WA anyway? Maybe demonstrate, quantify and communicate benefits for broadacre agriculture. Benchmark against common non-native pastures, that's pretty important. And profitable, reliable approaches will pretty much drive adoption. So if you want markets for your native seed, we've got 13 million hectares in WA and probably a lot over here as well. You're going to have to try and get the cost of the seed right down and reliable. Thank you.
Everybody happy? You want to go for coffee?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.